Recorded Books and RB Digital present Syndromes, Science Fiction Stories by Alec Nevala-Lee. Narrated by Catherine Ho and Jonathan Todd Ross. A quote from Gregory Bateson, Steps to an Ecology of Mind. We deal with not a single syndrome, but with a genus of syndromes, most of which are not conventionally regarded as pathological. Chapter 1. Ernesto, 1937. From the Paris Review, 1958. Interviewer. Who would you say are your literary forebears, those you have learned the most from? Hemingway. Mark Twain, Flaubert, Chekhov, Van Gogh, Gauguin, San Juan de la Cruz. A year after the war began, I found myself in Madrid, where I took a room at the Hotel Florida. In those lean months, breakfast usually consisted of little more than a few bits of dry bread from the night before. But one morning, as I was nursing a cup of weak tea and some stale crusts in the lobby, I noticed the smell of fresh coffee and fried ham drifting down from somewhere overhead. I set my notes aside. At first, I tried to ignore the aroma, which I sensed would mean trouble, but in the end, I gathered up my things and took the elevator to the fourth floor. The two stories above had been shelled not long ago, and it was the highest level that was still occupied. When I arrived at the room, the door was open. Hemingway, who insisted that I call him Ernesto, although I was no more Spanish than he was seated by the window with a newspaper. Looking around the cramped space, I took in the typewriter, the gramophone, and the cooking ring with its traces of breakfast. When my eyes reached the chair by the bed, I paused. Seated there, instead of the woman I had expected, was a man in a dark suit and glasses. Excuse me, I said, taking a step backwards. I didn't know you had company. Ernesto set down the paper, eyeing me through the steel rims of his spectacles. He was in his 30s then, his hair and mustache still black, the prow of his chest barely restrained by his dressing gown. No, have coffee with us, Ernesto said. You might find this interesting. The padre and I were speaking of miracles. I believe we had just reached the subject of the stigmata. Going over to the windowsill to get a cup of coffee, I studied the visitor more closely. The fact that he was wearing civilian clothes wasn't surprising. At that point, a year into the war, several thousand clergymen had already died at the hands of the loyalists, who equated the church with the hated aristocrats. A priest visiting Madrid couldn't be blamed for leaving his cassock at home. Taking my cup, I sank into the chair closest to the electric heater. What about the stigmata? Your American friend is a skeptic of the modern school, the priest said, speaking in good English. He is willing to embrace any evidence that supports his political beliefs, but not if it contradicts them, not even something so compelling as the five wounds of Christ. Ernesto lit a cigarette. I'm only saying that no miracle is required. Even if we discount the possibility of fraud, the mind can do strange things to the body. What you call divine intervention might be nothing but hysteria. But what if other factors are present? The priest asked. Consider the case that brings me here today. Yesterday I arrived from Segovia, where I was asked to provide safe conduct for a woman who had been staying at our convent. Only 4 weeks ago, her body was racked with carcinoma. The doctors gave her at most a few months to live. Instead of resigning herself to death, she came to us, wanting nothing more than to pray to St. John. St. John of the Cross, Ernesto said for my benefit. He is buried in Segovia. To pray for his intervention, the priest said, continuing without a pause. 4 days on end, she prostrated herself in his chapel, taking only a little food and water. After 2 weeks, she began to tremble. The marks of the holy nails appeared on her hands and feet. In time, the stigmata went away, and when the wounds faded, her cancer too was gone. A good story, Ernesto said, but again, no miracle is required. Any doctor can tell you tales of spontaneous remission. Most of the time, the patient never really had cancer at all. But I have spoken to her doctor myself. There is no medical explanation. She was dying but has recovered completely, and... The priest paused, as if wondering whether he should speak further, and lowered his voice. And she is not the only one. We know of at least 4 other cases in Madrid alone. All were men and women who visited the tomb of St. John in the past year. All were dying of cancer. And after they prayed for the saint's intervention, all were cured. What is this if not a miracle? Ernesto shot me a glance. I could tell that he didn't believe a word, but he turned back politely to the priest. You say that this woman is in Madrid. Would it be possible for me to see her? I was hoping you would ask, the priest said. She lives nearby, off the Gran Via. Good. Ernesto rose, brushing the crumbs from his dressing down. If you'd like to wait downstairs, I'll join you in a minute. The priest bowed and left the room. As soon as he was gone, Ernesto went into the bathroom, leaving the door open so we could talk. He had arrived in the city not long before, working for a syndicate as a war correspondent, and we had become fast friends. So, what do you think? I finished my coffee and put the cup on the sill. It's hard to believe that a shrine like that could go unreported. Lord doesn't have as many cures in a century. If it were real, we would have heard about it. That isn't necessarily true, Ernesto said, reappearing in a fresh shirt, his hair wet. It's dangerous to believe in miracles these days. Too many Catholics have died already. No, what I find more interesting is the timing. You've heard the talk of a Zagovia offensive? Only a few rumors. I watched as Ernesto went to the armoire in the corner. Segovia, which lay across the mountains to the north, had been taken by the nationalists in the early days of the war, and it was widely assumed that the loyalists would soon try to recapture the town from the fascists. Ernesto opened the armoire. This shrine is just outside Segovia. The town has already been bombed once. Churches have been burned to the ground. If I were this priest and wanted to save my monastery, I might try to convince our side that a miracle was taking place there. Inside the armoire, I saw rows of contraband chocolate bars, canned foods, whiskey. But why did he come to you? He must want me to write about it. Maybe he thinks I'll influence opinion overseas, or hopes I'll spread word to the loyalist command. It wouldn't be the first time I've been asked to do this. Taking a can of bully beef and a tin of milk from the nearest shelf, Ernesto closed the armoire. Come on, we'll see this woman together. Maybe you'll get a story out of it too. Going downstairs, we found the priest waiting in the lobby. Outside, the ground was strewn with broken glass, and fresh craters had been left by last night's bombardment. After walking for some time along the Gran Via, we found ourselves in an area that was relatively untouched by bombs. On the porch of the nearest house, in the shade of the overhang, sat a woman in black. Removing our hats, we mounted the steps together. The woman watched us curiously. She looked to be in her late 50s, and her features were wrinkled and kind. The priest greeted her warmly, saying that we wanted to ask her some questions. Ernesto hung back, leaving the priest to do the talking, although his eyes studied the woman's face with what struck me as a predatory attentiveness. As the priest questioned her, the woman replied softly. Yes, the doctors had told her that she was going to die. Yes, she had gone to pray at the tomb of the blessed saint, even though it meant going into nationalist territory. And yes, she had felt the Holy Spirit take hold of her body, leaving its marks on her flesh. At the priest's urging, she showed us her hands. On the center of each palm, I saw a faint welt, no longer than a peseta piece. Each formed a neat circle with its edges cleanly demarcated. The welts had faded since their first appearance, she told us, but they still bothered her occasionally. You mentioned a doctor, Ernesto said. You've seen him since you got back? The woman glanced at the priest, who nodded. Yes, she said, she had seen the doctor, who had been amazed to find that her sickness was gone. Ernesto obtained the doctor's name and took out the tins of food, which the woman, after a show of protestation, was persuaded to accept. After exchanging a few words with the priest who remained at the house, we headed off. I turned to Ernesto. So, what do you think? I think she's telling the truth, Ernesto said, or at least as much as she understands. In any case, I know her doctor. Maybe I'll see him today. It's probably nothing, but you never know. At the hotel, we parted ways. I spent the rest of the day writing up a dispatch, which I cabled to my paper. That night, when I went for dinner on the Gran Via, the restaurant was already packed. Looking for a place to sit, I saw Ernesto at a table in the corner. He seemed tired, but he signaled for me to come over. I can't make head or tail of the damned thing, Ernesto said. The doctor confirmed it. Not only is this woman's story true, but he's seen 3 spontaneous remissions in the past 6 months, all patients with terminal cancer. They don't always say where they've been, but it's clear that they've all gone to Segovia. I picked at my plate of horse meat with rice. And he's sure that the cancer is gone? Ernesto poured himself another glass of wine. As sure as anyone can be. He's got his hands full with the wounded, so he can't track every patient's progress. Except for the most recent case, he can't testify to the stigmata. But he showed me the records himself. These are all patients who were given only a few months to live. Now they're in the best of health. Pushing the plate aside, I reached for my wine glass. So, what are you going to do? I'm going to Segovia. The padre needs a ride back anyway, so I'm driving up there tomorrow. Raising his glass, he fixed me with those penetrating eyes. I was hoping you might join me. I didn't reply at once. Over the past year, I had taken my share of risks, but it was one thing to wind up in danger by accident and quite another to drive on purpose into fascist territory. As I opened my mouth to decline, the bomb exploded. The sound began as a whine like a plucked guitar string and deepened into the roar of an approaching train. When the shell went off, it was very close by, and the entire restaurant trembled. The conversation died out for a second before returning to its customary din. But we were all a little shaken. It struck me then that one might die as easily in Madrid as anywhere else, and at least the front offered the prospect of movement and fresh air. As I sat there, I also thought of a man I had known, who would have encouraged me to observe such a problem firsthand. And I saw now that I had been unconsciously awaiting this kind of mystery. All right, I'll come. Good, Ernesto said, draining his glass with a gulp. We'll make an adventure of it. The next morning, before dawn, I found Ernesto waiting for me outside our hotel. Behind the wheel of his car sat Ippolito, the latest and most reliable of his drivers. After making a detour to pick up the priest, who slid beside me into the back seat, we headed out of the city. It was a cold morning on the meseta, and the wind bore wave after wave of dust from the mountains. As the sun rose to our right, it gradually illuminated the landscape outside Madrid. Raw military roads had been cut across the plain, and at the edges of the paths I saw abandoned equipment and holes from recent bombardments. In the distance, I could make out a line of troops, their cars and tanks covered with freshly cut branches, the soldiers like ants in their steel helmets. Ahead of us ran a stretch of foothills clad in pine forest. The higher we climbed, the closer the sound of artillery became, and Ernesto handed back a wineskin to ease the tension. Warmed by the wine, which was resinous but welcome, the priest began to speak of the saint whose shrine we were going to see. When St. John tried to reform the Carmelites, his superiors threw him into prison, in a room barely large enough for him to lie down. He was taken out only to be lashed once a week, but one day, no one knows how, he miraculously escaped. Ernesto laughed. Not much of a miracle. He arranged to remove the hinges from the door of his cell. Now that's the kind of saint I can admire. He looked out at the trees. If John deserves sainthood, it's because he understood the dark night of the soul. You can look for God all your life and find nothing in the end. For a true believer, that nothingness is enough. Nada, y nada, y nada. We rounded a hairpin turn, bringing us into view of the northern plain. As we began our winding descent, the town of Zagovia appeared in the distance, as a few dark specks in a sea of orange. Overhead, I heard the sound of aircraft, and when I looked up, I saw three monoplanes flying in a nationalist patrol. We watched, uneasy, until the planes had gone, and then we continued on our way. As we approached Segovia, my first impression was that of a long tongue of crumbling stone. It was an ancient village girded by a vast aqueduct, with gray fortifications surrounding the town itself. Instead of driving under the main arch, which would have brought us into the plaza, we skirted the walls to the monastery, which lay to the northwest. We parked beneath a clump of trees 100 yards from the entrance. Climbing out, Ernesto told Ippolito to stay with the car. We followed the priest up the road, which led past a stone wall and a footpath lined with pines brought us to the monastery. Leading us through the heavy doors, the priest pointed toward the church and said that he would join us in a moment. He disappeared down the corridor. Taking off our hats, Ernesto and I passed into the church, moving along the aisle toward the altar. A door to the left led to the chapel, which we entered. Inside, it was darker than I had expected, with the windows piled high with sandbags, and the only light came from a few guttering candles. The atmosphere was warm and damp, with an odor of moist stone. Beyond the altar rails stood the tomb of St. John of the Cross, which was a massive reliquary of marble and bronze. On the floor before the altar lay what appeared to be two heaps of rags. A second later, one of the heaps moved, and I realized that they were a pair of visitants lying in front of the tomb. Looking more closely, I saw that they were a man and woman, their ages unclear. Something in their silent prostration gave me the feeling that they had been here for hours, or perhaps days. Glancing over at Ernesto, I saw that he was looking around the chapel with the same intent air that I had observed before. When I followed his eyes, I noticed fresh cracks in the floor and walls, and I recalled that this area had been bombed by the Loyalists in the early phases of the war. We stood there in silence, looking around the chapel's dim interior. After a moment, the priest rejoined us. "We have a number of guests with us," the priest said in a whisper, indicating the prone figures at the altar. "Another is staying upstairs. I have arranged for you to see him." Ernesto turned back to the reliquary. "What can you tell me about the tomb?" "St. John of the Cross died in Úbeda, and his body was brought here soon afterward," the priest said. "At first, he was interred below the floor. The tomb that you see here was installed 10 years ago." Ernesto ran his gaze across the marble monument. "And how did St. John die?" "A disease of the legs, I believe." The priest headed for the door. "Come, I'll bring you to our other guest." We followed him out of the chapel. Leaving the church, we ascended a flight of stone steps to a corridor lined with cells. The priest knocked softly at the nearest door before pushing it open. Inside, a man was seated at the edge of a pallet with a rosary clutched in his hands. As we entered, the visitant looked up, and I thought I saw something like holy fever in his eyes.
God be with you, my son, the priest said politely. And how are you feeling?
Better, the man said.
As he looked between us with a mild expression, the priest explained that he had recently arrived from Burgos, and that he had been diagnosed sometime before with an incurable carcinoma. In response to our request, the visitant extended his scrawny arms for us to examine. On the palms of his hands, which were trembling slightly, I observed the same markings that I had seen on the woman in Madrid. Without being asked, the visitant raised the hem of his robe, allowing us to look at his feet. They also bore marks that might have been those of stigmata, although they seemed larger than the wounds that nails would have made. On his legs, I saw what looked like a number of welts or bruises.
The marks of the flail, the priest said helpfully, where our Lord was beaten by the soldiers.
Of course, Ernesto said.
From his jacket pocket, he took a few sunflower seeds, which the visitant accepted gladly. As we filed out of the room, I saw that he had already turned back to his rosary. Going downstairs, we left the monastery, heading back to where we had left the car. Ippolito was leaning against the hood with his arms folded. As we drew close enough to see the driver in the shade, he gave us a quick nod of the head. Ernesto spoke quietly.
Watch out, we have a guest.
I turned. 50 yards away, leaning against the wall that encircled the monastery, there was a slender figure in a beret and overcoat. He was watching us. Ernesto frowned.
You know this man?
Yes, the priest said,
the color draining from his face.
He is one of the phalangists.
I was afraid of that, Ernesto signaled to Ippolito. Come on, let's leave this fascist bastard behind.
As I got into the car, I glanced back at the figure by the wall, who had begun to eye us more openly. Ernesto climbed into the front seat and glanced at the priest.
You'll be all right on your own?
Yes, I'll take care of it, the priest said. But you should go now. God be with you.
And also with you, Padre, Ernesto said.
As we drove away from the monastery, a cloud of dust rose behind the car. Looking over my shoulder, I saw the priest approaching the man in the beret, who was tracking us with his gaze. Then we rounded the corner and lost sight of them both. The drive back to the city was a long one. On our approach to Madrid, we passed within sight of a formation of reserve troops, possibly the same ones we had seen on our way to Segovia. At some point in the past few hours, they had been bombarded. Bodies lay on the ground, no more than lumps in the dirt, with medical crews and burial squads moving among the fallen. When we returned to the city, Ippolito dropped us off at the hotel. As we approached the entrance with the granite dust caking on our boots, Ernesto spoke at last.
The padre was braver than he looked. The fascists won't be pleased that he met with us, even if it turns out to have been for nothing.
We entered the hotel, passing between the two guards at the door.
So you still don't believe in miracles?
I'm not sure.
Ernesto headed for the concierge's desk.
Give me a few days.
As it turned out, I didn't talk to him again for the better part of the week. From time to time, I would see him in the lobby, a few books under one arm, or speaking to the medical officer of the 11th International Brigade, who was a German national with the eyes of a monk. I spent an afternoon leafing through a thick volume that I had brought from home, revisiting its accounts of cancer cures and miracles at Lourdes. But I found nothing that cast any light on our situation. One evening, however, as I was returning to the hotel, I found a note from Ernesto waiting for me at the front desk, asking if I would be kind enough to meet him at Chicote's. When I pushed through the revolving door that night, the bar was fairly quiet. Ernesto was seated at his favorite table,
under a window piled with sandbags, drinking a gin and tonic. Next to his glass, instead of the usual newspapers or political tracts, there was a stack of leather-bound books. Pulling up a chair, I saw that two were medical textbooks. One was a life of St. John of the Cross, and the last, unexpectedly, was an edition of the letters of Anton Chekhov.
"Don't be so surprised," Ernesto said, clearing a space for me to sit. "My father was a doctor. I even drove an ambulance during the war, so I know a few things about the body."
I ordered a whiskey. "But I assume that your interest was reawakened by our trip."
"I suppose you might say that," Ernesto said. "In fact, I have solved the mystery."
My incredulity must have shown on my face. Ernesto laughed and assured me that he was perfectly serious.
"First off, I hope you'll agree to exclude the possibility of miracles. My own feelings aside, the supernatural should be invoked only after all other possibilities have been excluded."
"Agreed," I said, taking a sip of the whiskey. "So how do you propose to begin?"
"With the facts. Take away the stigmata and the air of the mystical, and what do we have? A case of spontaneous remission. So I consulted the literature on the subject. These recoveries do happen, if rarely. According to one source, they occur in fewer than 1 in 100,000 cases."
Ernesto picked up a volume from the pile.
"This is an account of the work of William Coley, a surgeon who made the first systematic study of these remissions. As a young man, he was asked to consult on the case of a girl of 17, who complained of pain and swelling in her right hand. The biopsy revealed that she was suffering from a severe sarcoma. They amputated her arm below the elbow, but it was too late. A few months later, she died."
He opened the book, gently turning over the leaves.
"Another man might have moved on, but Coley was a gifted surgeon and still very young. He became obsessed with investigating cases of sarcoma, trying to discover how to treat such a terrible disease. During his research, he uncovered many instances of spontaneous remission, and he found that most of these cases had one thing in common."
I sensed that he was intentionally milking the drama, but I was willing to play along. "What did he find?"
"He found cases, some dating back a century or more, of cancer patients who experienced spontaneous remission after surviving a serious infection. When the immune system rallies to fend off a bacterial invasion, it seems, it can eliminate cancer as well. The body has wonderful defenses, but it doesn't always recognize cancer as a threat. An infection serves to mobilize the body against one enemy, while also taking care of a more insidious foe. Chekhov mentions this. He was a doctor, you know, and in one of his letters, he notes that when a patient develops erysipelas, a severe skin infection caused by streptococcus, the growth of tumors is also unchecked. So these observations go back a long time."
He closed the book.
"It's even possible, if you're so inclined, to draw an analogy to the present war. I'm not a communist and I have nothing against the church, but I want to destroy fascism. And the only way to do this is to align that struggle with the movements that also want to do away with capitalists and clergymen. In the short term, it leads to atrocities on both sides. But we can't stop fascism unless we connect the fight to an impulse that the people can understand."
"We're straying from the point, I think," I said. "What about William Coley?"
"After reviewing the literature, he began looking for instances of spontaneous remission that were closer to home. In particular, he heard about the case of a German immigrant who had been diagnosed with terminal sarcoma. Later, the patient came down with erysipelas, the kind of infection that Chekhov mentions, but he eventually recovered. Coley went searching for this patient, knocking on tenement doors, until he finally tracked him down. and what he found was that the patient was alive and free of cancer, apparently because of the infection he'd survived. I began to see where Ernesto was going. So we're talking about a cure for cancer? Coley certainly seemed to think so. He began to investigate the possibility of deliberately infecting cancer patients to trigger their natural immune defenses. He even developed an anti-tumor vaccine, a brew of microbes, including erysipelas bacteria, that could be injected directly into the body. The results were mixed. Some patients recovered, but others died. After all, there's always a chance that erysipelas itself might kill the patient. It can be a brutal disease. There's one famous case in particular that might be relevant here. I found that I knew exactly what he was going to say. St. John of the Cross. Ernesto nodded, pleased, as if I had passed a test. I've looked into the details. St. John came down with a fever, then an inflammation of the leg. It ulcerated and spread to his lower back, where it killed him. His biographers agree it was erysipelas, but let's file that fact away for now. Signaling to the waiter for another round, Ernesto picked up a handbook of infectious diseases. So what are the symptoms of erysipelas? It begins as a fever with tremors. A red, swollen, hardened rash appears, usually on the extremities, particularly the hands, feet, and legs. The rashes tend to be raised with sharply defined edges. In some cases, they take the form of elevated vesicles or blisters, not unlike, shall we say, the marks of a nail. The waiter arrived with our drinks, but I barely noticed. So you think these cases of stigmata were really erysipelas? It isn't so hard to believe. Imagine that round, hardened welts appear on a supplicant's hands and feet after a visit to the shrine. Someone else at the monastery takes them for stigmata. Then, as word gets around, later cases show the marks even more clearly. Why? Because everyone knows what stigmata are supposed to look like. The mind influences the size and location of the markings. The cycle feeds on itself. All it takes is a certain degree of credulity. Hold on, I said. So you're saying that these miracles are due to visitors to the shrine being infected by erysipelas? Their symptoms are mistaken for stigmata. Because the war has reduced their access to medical care, they don't receive the usual diagnosis or treatment, but if they survive the infection on their own, it drives off their cancer. But are you telling me that they've been infected by the body of a saint who died over 3 centuries ago? That's something I found hard to accept, too, Ernesto said. But look at the circumstances. A reliquary is an ideal place for bacteria to grow. Staphylococcus, for instance, has been found thriving in newly opened tombs. And you've seen that chapel. Visitors lie on the floor for hours at a time. They're near death, undernourished, vulnerable to infection, in a dark, damp place that has been recently disturbed by bombing. And any battlefield doctor can tell you that bombardment releases microbes that have been dormant in the landscape for a long time. I remembered Ernesto's conversation with the doctor at the International Brigade. Is that why you spoke to Dr. Heilbrunn? Yes. And he reminded me of a case I might otherwise have forgotten. I imagine that you've heard of it. A tomb was reopened after thousands of years. Soon after the excavation, a number of those involved died, including the man who financed the dig, which led to certain fantastic theories. Well, the tomb was that of Tutankhamun. The man was Lord Carnarvon, and he died of erysipelas. We fell silent. I became aware that I had drunk too much. So what are you going to do about it? Ernesto contemplated his glass for a moment. He took a careful swig. Nothing. Nothing? My head was throbbing and I had trouble understanding what he meant. What are you talking about? He didn't respond right away.
Around us, the bar was packed with journalists, soldiers, and girls. And when he spoke again, I had to listen carefully to hear him over the crowd.
"We have to consider the larger picture," Ernesto said slowly. "The Segovia offensive needs to take place. If we don't recapture Segovia, Franco will push north until he reaches Bilbao, which will cut the loyalists in half. If that happens, the war is lost. From there, there's no guessing which path the world will take. And if I write about the shrine, it will only complicate the situation."
He looked into his glass, which was nearly empty.
"That's the strange thing, you see. The priest came to me because he thought word of a miracle might discourage the attack. He was wrong, of course. The last thing the loyalists want is to give legitimacy to the church. But when you cast things in scientific terms..."
Ernesto paused.
"That's a different story. The socialists have made a fetish of science. They'll want to look into it or postpone the offensive until they have more information. And I can't allow that to happen."
"But what if you're right?" I asked. "If the chapel contains a cure for cancer, are you willing to throw that away?"
"I'm willing to make the hard choice. Perhaps a handful of men and women will die without this cure. On the other hand, we have the future of a nation, even the world, to consider."
"You've seen the forces at play here. Sarcoma is nothing compared to the cancer of fascism.
If you don't believe me, imagine how Europe will look in a few years if that cancer isn't snuffed out now."
I weighed this in silence. Deep down, I saw that there was nothing I could do. I was neither famous nor expert enough to make the case for the shrine on my own. The only man I knew who might have been capable of it had been dead for years. And there was always the possibility that Ernesto was right.
"Well, hell," I said at last. "If that's what you've decided, I'm not going to stop you."
Ernesto only finished his drink without meeting my eyes. It was too loud to talk any further, so we paid the bill and left. Outside, the city was very quiet. We headed back to the Hotel Florida, moving silently through the ruined streets, and parted ways at the elevator. I don't think we even said goodbye. Ernesto left the city soon afterward. I stayed for another few months, long enough to see the failure of the Segovia offensive, which began 3 weeks after his departure. Even after it became clear that the assault had fallen short, it was difficult to understand how things had gone so badly. After suffering more than 1,000 casualties, the offensive faltered and fell back. In the end, it succeeded in delaying the capture of Bilbao by less than 2 weeks. After that, I only saw Ernesto once more. A year after the war ended, I wound up in Havana, where I learned that he was staying at an estate 15 miles from the city. On an impulse, I gave him a call. Rather to my surprise, he agreed to see me that day, if I would be willing to drive up to the house. When I arrived at the estate, which the locals called the Finca Vigia, it was lunchtime. I rang the bell and Martha let me inside. She was as beautiful as always, and she seemed glad to see me. Showing me into the study, she left us alone, saying that she would bring some food. Ernesto was seated at his desk, wearing a soft red robe. Beside the typewriter lay a heap of manuscript pages. I had heard that he was working on a novel inspired by the Segovia offensive, and I asked if he had a title yet. He said he was thinking of calling it The Undiscovered Country. In response to his questions, I told him that I had recently married, and that my wife and I hoped to visit Alaska soon.
"There may be a story there, another mystery. I thought you might want to hear the details."
"I have mysteries enough here."
Waving me toward a seat, Ernesto leaned back in his chair.
"Any news of the Padre?"
"Yes," I said, accepting a glass of scotch from Martha, who set down a tray and left the room. "He was shot by the Falangists a month after our visit. For all I know, it was because they saw him with us."
Damn them, Ernesto said mildly. But it's hard to be sure about these things.
What about the chapel?
As far as I can tell, the cures have ceased. Visitants kept coming, but after a while there were no more recoveries. Nobody knows why, although I hear that the monastery was disinfected from top to bottom after a typhus scare. Ernesto straightened out the papers on his desk.
It isn't surprising. Microbes change character quickly, like men.
So perhaps the factors that made the cure possible simply ceased to exist. He took a sip of his drink.
In any event, it's for the best. The last thing we need is for Franco to lay claim to a shrine. You can imagine how he would treat it. It would become a fascist lord, proof that his regime had been blessed by heaven. Better for it to disappear altogether.
He cleared his throat.
Perhaps I also overestimated myself. I solved the mystery, but I misread the more important signs. There are forces at work that are too powerful for a single man to change. And what we saw in Spain may only be the beginning of a larger pattern.
We lapsed into a rather melancholy silence. After a moment, the alcohol spreading through my body prompted me to speak more philosophically than usual. Finishing my drink, I said, "You know, the Loyalist Republic never would have lasted. A government that is utterly opposed to the church can't survive for long. The need for faith runs too deep." I paused. In time, if things had been different, even the Loyalists might have realized this. Ernesto, in his red robe, looked out the window at the sea. On the surface of the water, the sun was beating down in a long white line.
"Yes," Ernesto said at last, draining his glass of scotch. "Isn't it pretty to think so?"
Chapter 2. The Spires, 1938. A quote by Charles Fort from New Lands. In the English Mechanic, September 10, 1897, a correspondent to the Weekly Times and Echo is quoted. Early in June 1897, he had seen a city pictured in the sky of Alaska. Not one of us could form the remotest idea in what part of the world this settlement could be. Some guessed Toronto, others Montreal, and one of us even suggested Peking. It is evident that it must be the reflection of some place built by the hand of man. According to this correspondent, the mirage did not look like one of the cities named, but like some immense city of the past. Bill Lawson studied the silent city. The photograph in his hands was the size of a postcard, creased at the corners and brittle with age. It depicted a cascade of roofs and chimneys emerging from what appeared to be a fog bank, its upper half obscured by clouds, with something like the spire of a church faintly visible in the distance. After examining the picture for another moment, he returned it to the man on the other side of the desk. "What about it?" The photo went back into the valise from which it had emerged.
"Ever heard of a prospector called Dick Willoughby?"
"Sure, an old sourdough before my time. Willoughby Island is named after him."
"That's right."
The visitor, who had introduced himself as Sam Russell, was in his late 40s, with eyes that looked as if they had been transplanted there from the sockets of a much older man. He claimed that every year in Glacier Bay, between June and July, a city appeared in the sky to the northwest, above the Fairweather Range. He went back three times to get a picture of it. Finally, he came up with this photo. He sold copies of it to tourists. Lawson checked to see if Russell was joking, but the older man kept a straight face.
"It looks fake to me."
"Oh, it is," Russell grinned. "It's a picture of Bristol in England. Either Willoughby was deliberately lying or somebody sold him a plate of the city and convinced him that it was taken here in Alaska. I'm inclined to think that he was a victim of a hoax, but that's interesting in itself. It means he thought that this picture resembled whatever he saw in the sky, you see? Lawson decided to ignore the question. So why are you showing it to me? I want you to fly me to Willoughby Island so I can take a look for myself. Lawson paused before responding. He prided himself on being a decent judge of character, but Russell was hard to pin down. The coat that he had hung by the door was rumpled but expensive, like his traveling case, and the bundle by his feet included a surveyor's tripod and a camera. He certainly didn't resemble the hunters or prospectors who tended to come through Juneau these days, the flow of whom had slowed to a trickle in the depths of the Great Depression. It occurred to Lawson that the other man might be toying with him. People from the outside often assumed that the locals were simpletons, when the opposite was more likely to be true. Seeing himself through Russell's eyes, he knew that he didn't cut an impressive figure, with his untucked shirt tail, oily jacket, and busted nose, and he felt a twinge of resentment at being mistaken for a rube. I wonder if you're having a laugh at my expense. Not at all. I just want to be clear about what I'm doing. It seemed better to tell you the most ridiculous version now, so there won't be any confusion later, but I'm serious. I've spoken to other eyewitnesses, and I have good reason to believe that Willoughby did see something in the sky. Even if it's only an optical phenomenon, it's worth investigating. Russell glanced at his watch. But I should come to the point. I'm interested in doing research on Willoughby Island, and I'm willing to pay cash up front. I've been told that the flight shouldn't take more than 40 minutes, which means I'll be back in time to buy you dinner. Lawson remembered that Russell had mentioned arriving from Seattle the night before. You came a long way for a day trip. There may be a second stop, or even a third, I'll tell you once I know more. Lawson paused again. Two dueling impulses were at war in his mind, and he finally yielded to caution. Sorry, I can't fly you into Glacier Bay. Nobody can. Maybe no one explained it to you, but it's a protected area. I could cut you a deal on a sightseeing trip, but we can't land. Russell absorbed the news without any visible reaction. It has to be on the ground. Then you can take a boat up there. There are plenty of fishermen on the docks who might agree to it. That won't work. It took longer for me to get here than I hoped, and I'm at the end of my available window. I can't waste any time. If you won't take me, I'll find someone who will. Lawson heard the unspoken implication. There were several other pilots in town who would welcome the charter, legal or not, and the plain fact which was written on his face was that he needed the money. He wondered if Russell could sense his desperation, and he found that he didn't want to give the other man the satisfaction even if they never met again. You expect to see a city in the sky? Not really, Russell said. But I want the chance. It would mean a great deal to me and to my wife. Lawson was about to respond when he saw a figure outlined against the window that faced the street. A moment later, the door opened and a woman entered the office. As the two men rose, Russell introduced her. This is my wife, Cora. She'll be coming too, if we can reach an agreement. The woman didn't sit down. She wasn't pretty exactly, but she had red hair, green eyes, and a face that would be hard to forget. Lawson saw that she was much younger than her husband, probably no more than 30, and as he looked at her, he found that he had come to a decision. Taking a seat again, Lawson began to play with the cord of the window shade behind his desk. If we're doing this, it has to be done right. There can't be any record. I won't put it down on the flight plan. A satisfied look spread across Russell's features. What do you have in mind? Lawson let go of the cord. Opening a drawer, he fished out a stained topographical map, which he unrolled across the desk. Willoughby Island was an oval the size of the palm of his hand, nestled like a turtle in the blue ribbon of Glacier Bay.
Where were you hoping to land?
Russell pointed. The southern tip. It's where the most credible sighting took place.
We can't. The shore is too bold. There's nowhere to tie up the plane.
Lawson indicated an area to the northeast.
There's a cove here, maybe even a floating deck. Used to be a fox farm there. It might even be worth my while to check it out.
He glanced down at Russell's shoes, which turned out to be a pair of good boots.
You'll have to hike 4 miles along the beach. It shouldn't take more than a couple of hours. We can still get you home by dinner time.
Russell glanced at his wife, who gave him a short nod.
When can we leave?
10 minutes after I get paid.
Lawson rolled up the map.
Normally, the charter would come to $70 apiece. Let's call it 80, given the risk of trouble on my end. Before he had even finished speaking, Russell pulled out his wallet and counted 820s onto the desktop. Lawson pocketed the money.
You know where the lower city float is?
I can find it. Let's meet in half an hour. I need to make a phone call from the hotel.
Fine with me. You're each allowed 20 pounds of baggage.
Lawson stuck out a hand.
Glad to do business with you.
Same here.
Russell's grip was firm. He retrieved his coat from the peg and left with his wife, whose eyes lit briefly on Lawson on the way out. She hadn't spoken a word since her arrival. Half an hour later, they were in the plane, heading out into the channel for takeoff. On his way to the docks, Lawson had made a stop at the grocer. It had been a hungry couple of months, and although he was tempted to stock up on treats, he had restricted himself to a bag of sandwiches, a Horlicks rum fudge bar, and a few squares of mint cake, one of which he devoured in front of the store. His plane, a yellow and blue Stinson on Fairchild floats, occupied a rented hangar at the southern end of town, past the docks on high pilings where boats and fishing vessels were tied up at the pier. As he descended the wooden steps to the shoreline, he had been pleasantly conscious of the bills in his pocket, as well as the expectation that there might be more to come. Somewhat to his surprise, Sam Russell and his wife had turned out to be familiar with the rituals of departure. Without being instructed, they kept their bags on their laps, placing the weight toward the front of the plane, and as he opened up the engine and rocked the stick, his passengers swayed along with it, helping to jockey the floats up onto their steps for takeoff. They broke loose from the surface, the water rising around them in a fine spray, and then they were airborne. As the plane climbed, Lawson looked back at the others. "We'll fly over Douglas Island to the channel, then head across the Chilcat Range. Should be on our way down in half an hour." Russell nodded and returned his gaze to the window. Cora kept her eyes fixed on the landscape below. Lawson turned to the windshield again. He decided to take a scenic route, bending up and around the Bear Track Mountains, before heading down into the bay. Russell and his wife would probably leave town before long, he thought, but there was still a chance that they might stick around. A pilot could survive on just one regular charter, and if he failed to land this one, it might be his last chance for a while. The flight passed without any conversation. Below them, the forests on the mountainsides gave way to the snowfields of the ridgetop, which was white even in the middle of July. The glaciers descending to the sea with their compressed layers of thousands of years of ice and snow were a deep emerald. It was a sight that could reduce even the most jaded travelers to awed silence. But if the Russells were impressed, they kept it to themselves. Before long, they neared their destination. Lawson zeroed in, checking the approach as he circled around toward the cove. The island was 4 miles from north to south, the thick spruce woods on its eastern edge ascending to low mountains, bounded on all sides by the waters of Glacier Bay. To the northeast were two smaller outlying islets, one of which was joined to the larger island by the gravel bar where he planned to bring them down. As they descended, Lawson saw that the floating dock was still there.
he made the landing upwind to reduce his forward speed. Once the floats were on the water, he cut the propeller as low as it would go and steered the plane like a boat to the pier, where he cut the engine and climbed out. Lawson secured the lines as his passengers picked their way toward shore. Gulls were pecking on the pebble beach, and a flock of murrelets circled overhead. The temperature was in the high 40s with just a few tufted clouds to the south, although he knew that the weather could change without warning. He tied up the plane and joined the couple by the Fox Farm, which consisted of a log cabin, a warehouse, and a line of trap houses stretching along the edge of the water. Back in the 20s, many islands had been leased to raise blue foxes, which were left to roam freely before being trapped. The Depression had destroyed the fur market overnight, and now most of these farms were abandoned. Approaching the black trunks of the spruce, Lawson saw that Russell and his wife seemed tense. "Everything good?" Russell turned south. "I'll hike down there on my own. Cora will stay behind to get some work done. The log cabin looks sound enough. I assume that you'll stick with the plane?" Lawson nodded. "I'll pick through these shacks to see if there's anything worth saving, but I can get you set up here first." This last remark was addressed to Cora, who looked back coolly. "I'll be fine." It was the first time she had spoken to him directly. He looked back without lowering his eyes. "You know where to find me. I'd like to be in the air by 8 so we can get back before dark." "Then I'd better be on my way." Russell appeared to hesitate, as if hoping that Cora would decide to come along after all. But she only picked up her bag and walked toward the cabin. He hefted his own pack onto his back, balancing the tripod on one shoulder, and began to hike down the sand. After a minute, he rounded the bend in the shore and was gone. Lawson saw that Cora had already entered the cabin and closed the door behind her. He headed off, whistling tunelessly, and made his way to the warehouse that stood nearby. For the next few hours, he explored the farm. He had hoped to find some equipment to resell, but it had all been picked clean. The warehouse was bare except for 2 chairs and a chopping block. Next to it was a trap house made of unfinished lumber, where food had been set out twice a week for the foxes. When it was time to harvest the pelts, a cleat was removed, allowing the floor to tilt down under the animal's weight, depositing it into a trap on the lowest level. Then a counterweight would return the floor to its original position, ready for its next victim. As he was picturing this, Lawson felt the walls of the shack vibrate around him. Stepping outside, he saw that the wind had picked up, and that the birds on the beach had vanished. He turned to the south. At some point over the last hour, the clouds on the horizon had grown more threatening. Lawson sized them up. Then he went up to the cabin and rapped on the door. After a pause, Cora spoke from inside. "Come in." He entered the cabin, which was a cramped space with bare beams. Cora had hung her coat from one of the pole racks, revealing her white-collared shirt and wool sweater. She rose from the table by the window where she had been writing something in longhand. "What is it?" Lawson stuck his thumb toward the sound of the wind. "You'd better go up the beach to look for your husband. If you see him, tell him to hustle. Don't go too far. If he doesn't show up soon, we'll be here overnight." Without waiting for a reply, he left the cabin and headed toward the dock. The wind was sending up a noticeable chop, and the plane was beginning to bob up and down on its lines. Lawson set to work at once, winding a cable around the float struts and the forward spreader bar to secure it to the pilings. He tied additional ropes to both wings, and then he used the bilge pump to fill the pontoons with water. Finally, he got out his overnight gear. In the back of the Stinson, there was a bundle of egg crate slats that he kept for makeshift repairs. He stuck them under his arm. A light rain was falling. Checking the log cabin and the warehouse, he saw that both seemed reasonably sturdy. After a moment's thought, he went into the cabin and set down his equipment. Using a mint cake wrapper for kindling in a few of the wood slats, he started a fire in the barrel stove. Then he pulled up a chair, lit a cigarette, and settled in to wait. Cora returned 15 minutes later with her hair plastered against her head from the rain. "He's not back?" Lawson motioned toward the second chair. "You should rest. No point in taking off in weather like this. We're spending the night no matter what happens." He anticipated her next question. "I'll sleep in the warehouse. There are two more bags. If we're lucky, your husband will make it back before dark." He offered her a smoke. She took it and sat close to the fire, looking toward the shuttered window. Outside, the rain was lashing down in sheets. Lawson ground out his cigarette. If he's smart, he'll find somewhere to wait out the storm. He should do fine under the trees as long as he's got wool socks and underwear. Once this blows over, he can follow the shoreline back. Cora didn't respond. After a minute, he offered her one of the sandwiches, which she accepted, and a swig from his flask, which she declined. As the wind howled against the cabin like a living creature, Lawson tried to get her mind off of it. "How long you been married?" For a second, Cora looked as if she hadn't understood the question.
6 months.
He wanted to ask how she had ended up with this man, but he bit it back. "I guess this wasn't the honeymoon you wanted." For the first time, she smiled at him.
"Actually, it's exactly what I had in mind."
Lawson wasn't sure what to say in response. On the table, Cora had spread out a few pages of handwritten notes, along with the photo of the silent city. He indicated it. "You really believe in all this?" Cora followed his eyes and looked back.
"Are you married, Mr. Lawson?"
Lawson grinned. "Not exactly. Not a lot of eligible girls where I'm from."
"If you were married, you'd know that it doesn't matter what I believe."
She paused.
"Sam and I have more in common than you might think. We're both stubborn. It's hard to get an idea out of his head, even if he has to go halfway across the world to prove it. I'm the same way."
"What does he do for a living?" Lawson asked. He wasn't too clear on the subject.
"He's a writer," Cora said.
"A journalist. He was in Spain during the war. Before that, he worked for Scripps Howard."
"I think you have a mutual friend there, a columnist named Ernie Pyle."
Lawson recognized the name. In better times, reporters had come up to Juneau once every couple of months to get fresh copy, and he had taken a few of them on glory hops into the interior. "Are you a writer too?"
"You might say that. Sam and I are working on a book. This will be one of the chapters, assuming..."
She broke off. For the first time, he saw the strain in her face.
"Are you worried?"
"No." Cora glanced at the shutters, which were shaking against the frame.
"Sam can handle himself. He doesn't take anything for granted. And maybe this will even teach him a lesson."
She stood abruptly.
"I'm very tired. If we're staying here, I'd like to go to bed."
"Of course." Lawson picked up his bag. "There's firewood in the corner. You can come get me if you need anything." Cora held his gaze.
"Thank you. I'm sure I'll be fine. Good night, Mr. Lawson."
"Good night." Lawson left the cabin, shutting the door, and heard her slide the bolt home. Then he crossed the short distance to the warehouse, his shoulders hunched against the rain. Once he was inside, he hung his coat from the rafters to dry. There was a stove in the corner, but instead of lighting a fire, he rolled out his sleeping bag and climbed in, listening to the whistle of the wind. Lawson closed his eyes. He had not expected to fall asleep at once, but he did. A few hours later, he sat up in the darkness. It took him a moment to remember what had pulled him out of sleep. He had been dreaming of the foxes. They had stood in a ring around the warehouse, their golden eyes shining in the darkness. And when he had gone to meet them, he had seen a woman in their midst, her body white, her red hair tumbling down her back. She had beckoned him. He had followed, his desire stirring, and his steps had carried him to a trap house on the shore. A voice in his head had screamed at him to stop, but he had continued on, walking up the ramp toward the black hole of the door.
He had entered, the smell of blood strong in his nose, and it was only when the floor fell out from under his feet that he knew. Lawson shook his head, rising back into full conscious, and finally remembered what had awakened him. He had heard a noise from outside. A second later, it came again, faintly audible over the wind rattling the building. It was the sound of wood splintering and breaking. He climbed out of his bag, stuffed his feet into his boots, and yanked his coat from the rack. Stumbling out of the warehouse, he ran down the slope of the beach to the water. The wind had risen to a gale, and the rain was pouring down hard. But when his eyes adjusted to the dark, he saw that two of his lines had come loose, and the plane was standing on its nose in the water. Lawson sprinted forward. Before he had covered 10 paces, there was a crack, and the plane was borne up by the wind. It did a loop and a snap roll, as if controlled by unseen hands, and then it plummeted and crashed with a shudder into the gravel bar at the end of the island. A quote by Charles Fort from New Lands. Every year between June 21st and July 10th, a phantom city appears in the sky, over a glacier in Alaska. Features of it had been recognized as buildings in the city of Bristol, England, so that the mirage was supposed to be a mirage of Bristol. It is said that, except for slight changes, from year to year, the scene was always the same. Cora found him early the next morning. Lawson had managed to get the plane partway up the slope of the beach, and he was laying out his equipment on the shore when she approached, wrapped up in her overcoat and scarf. "Sam didn't come back last night. Have you?" She broke off as soon as she saw the extent of the damage. "Can it still fly?" Lawson straightened up. He was aching all over, and this wasn't a conversation that he particularly wanted to be having. "Not like this." A chunk came off the tip of the propeller. "One of the wing struts is buckled, the ribs are broken, and there's a big crack in the windshield. We're stuck, for now." Cora appeared to consider this. The wind carried strands of hair away from her face. "Have you radioed for help?" Lawson didn't bother saying that he had spent the last few hours trying not to lose the plane altogether. Instead, he gestured at the radio that he had started to unpack. "Give me a hand." With her lips pressed tightly together, Cora listened to his instructions. Lawson had already cut a pole from timber on the beach, and he told her how to unwind and string up the antenna. As Cora held the pole upright, he fiddled with the receiver unit. It was a used Lear set that he had bought a few years back, after the Civil Aviation Authority had mandated that two-way radios be installed on all planes. Until then, he had relied, like most bush pilots, on his telegraph keys. And he still had doubts about the new system, which was distinctly unreliable. The receiver was silent, not even static. He gestured for Cora to move the pole to another spot on the beach as he switched to the transmitter unit. Checking the dials, he saw nothing. He fiddled with it for a few minutes before giving up. Either there was a faulty component, which would mean taking it all apart and testing each piece, or the entire set was out of commission. In either case, it meant that they weren't likely to get any help from that direction. Cora set down the pole. "Someone will look for us if we don't come back, right?" "Normally, sure." Lawson rose. "If a plane doesn't turn up on time, they'll wait one day, maybe two, before starting a search. But not here. You heard what I told your husband. It's illegal to land in a protected area. I didn't put our destination on the flight plan. As far as anybody else knows, we went on a scenic circle tour over the glaciers. No one will be looking for us on Willoughby Island." Lawson fished out his cigarettes, which he had kept safe in an inside pocket. He saw that he had 7 left. When she refused his offer of a smoke, he lit it himself and shook out the match. "We have 2 options. Either we wait and hope that somebody stumbles across us by accident, which doesn't seem too likely, or we fly out of here on our own wings." Cora studied the wreck of the Stinson on the shore. "You can fix it yourself?" Probably, Lawson said. I've seen worse. But I don't know how long it will take. It sure won't be today. We've got enough food to last for a while, so you might even say we're lucky. Her face hardened into a mask of resolve. I'm going after Sam. Are you coming? You go ahead. I've got to stay with the plane. Lawson stooped to pick up a 5-gallon can. Take this to the cabin. Our emergency rations. Rice, hardtack, bouillon cubes, milk powder, flares. When you go out, bring some of the matches. If you need help, light a fire on the beach. Use spruce boughs. They should give you plenty of smoke. I'll come for you. Thanks. Cora took the can into her arms and headed for the cabin, picking her way up the beach. Lawson looked after her, waving away the mosquitoes until she was out of sight. Then he glanced up at the sky again. The gulls were back and the air was calm, but he knew how quickly that could change. He turned to the plane. Most of the repairs were fairly routine, but the propeller presented a problem. 6 inches had broken off one of the laminated wood blades. If he tried to take off with an unbalanced propeller, the forces could rip the engine right out. And if he couldn't fix it, nothing else mattered. Keeping that fact tucked in the back of his mind, Lawson set to work. He drilled holes on either side of the break in the windshield and laced them together with wire, patching up the makeshift suture with tape. Earlier that morning, he had found an old gas can in the warehouse. After flattening it out, he nailed it to the top of the wing spar and fastened it over the leading edge, resulting in a kind of truss that he hoped would keep the wing together until he got to Juno. Lawson took a step back to assess the battered Stinson, which had consumed so much of his life. He had come to Alaska at 20, a restless kid drawn to the blank page of the North, which had stood in his mind for the untouched future. After teaching himself how to fly, reveling in the freedom that it afforded, he had gone into business for himself, buying a wrecked plane for $1 and raising the money to rebuild it from local shop owners and dentists, all of whom believed that the town was bound to benefit from its position on the map. The Depression had made nonsense of his intentions. He had flown fish trap patrol for the canneries, and after that dried up, he had turned to less reputable charters. Reporters no longer came on glory hops, so he ferried men out to the mines instead, going to beer parlors and asking the owners to point out customers whose pockets were empty. Flying a dead body home was guaranteed to pay both ways. At his lowest point, he had flown 3 prostitutes to a floating shack that was towed from one mine to another. The youngest had been no more than 16. Lawson blinked away the memory. He still had to fix the strut that held the wing to the fuselage. With some difficulty, he managed to straighten it out, using an old axe handle as a splint, which he bound securely with more wire. When he was done, he removed the propeller and wrapped it up, along with the broken tip. All the while, he kept a mental tally of the cost, which would more than swallow up whatever he had hoped to earn from the Russells. He ate half of his fudge bar and smoked a cigarette before heading back for the cabin. The propeller was tucked under one arm, and in his other hand, he carried his combination gun, which he had retrieved from under his seat in the cockpit. It was what the locals called a game-getter, with both rifled and shotgun barrels, and holding it made him feel less helpless. Lawson knew that there was no way that his partners would cover the cost of fixing the plane. Instead of giving him a salary, they paid him with stock in the company, which was effectively worthless. To survive, he dug clams and lived off his emergency rations. He had always accepted that he was on his own, but he didn't know how much longer he could last. One day soon, he sensed, the world would be done feeding him, and then he would be ready for the trap house. A stiff wind was blowing, making it hard for sound to travel. There was no sign of Cora or her husband. Lawson went into the warehouse where he set his gun on the chopping block and unwrapped the propeller. It would be best, he saw, to make a pattern of the broken tip, which would allow him to figure out where to cut down the other blade. He didn't have a pencil or paper, but then he remembered the notes that Cora had spread across the table in the next building. Lawson left the warehouse and entered the cabin, which was empty. There were a few sheets of notepaper and a pencil by the window, along with a pile of documents. He was picking up a blank page when his eye was caught by a newspaper clipping at the top. It was an article from the Washington Daily News dated earlier that year, and it carried Sam Russell's byline. For a long moment, Lawson just looked at it. He knew that he needed Russell and his wife more than they needed him. If he got them out of here in one piece, he might be able to make one last try for their business. And the best way to win them over was to figure out what they really wanted. Going to the door, he bolted it. Then he sat down at the table and began to look at the papers more carefully, hoping that they would tell him something more about the couple he had flown to the middle of nowhere. The first few clippings were all accounts of the Silent City, taken from periodicals like the New York Tribune and the Journal of the Royal Meteorological Society. There were pages torn from books by Minor Bruce and Alexander Badlam, a copy of For Whom the Bell Tolls, and a thick volume by a writer named Charles Fort. Then came several scientific papers, one by Oliver Heaviside, another by J.J. Thompson, and a third with the title Simplified Deduction of the Field and the Forces of an Electron Moving in Any Given Way. Lawson tried to read it and quickly gave up. But the other articles were easier to understand. So was the final item that he found, buried under the rest of the material. It was Russell's wallet. Lawson had already invaded the man's privacy in other ways, so it seemed like only a small step from there to looking inside. Taking out all the bills, he rifled through the stack. There were at least $300. Lawson was tempted. He didn't think that he could take all of it, but peeling off a few 20s as compensation for the plane didn't seem unreasonable. In the end, it was the memory of Russell's strangely old eyes that decided him. Russell was the kind of man, he reflected, who would keep track of what he carried. And perhaps there would be better ways to get at the money. He stuffed the bills into the wallet again. Taking out the broken tip of the propeller, he traced it carefully on the page. As he put the pencil back down, he concluded that his best hope was to cut down the other tip so that it matched. There was no balancing machine between here and Juno, so he would have to eyeball it and hope that it would get him off the ground. It was growing dark by the time Cora returned. Lawson had put a pot of rice on the fire, and he was smoothing down the rough edges of the broken tip. He had gone outside earlier and looked toward the mountain range to the northwest, but he had seen nothing unusual in the sky. Lawson glanced up as the door opened. Cora seemed exhausted, with her hair loose around her face, and he was suddenly reminded of his dream from the night before. No luck, I take it. She shook her head. Collapsing into a chair, she accepted a cup of broth, and when the rice was ready, she ate a bowl of it without speaking. Lawson saw that she was barely holding herself together, so he chose his next words with care. If he doesn't get back tonight, I can come with you tomorrow, as soon as I get the propeller back on the plane. He's probably just lost in the woods.
Sam's not lost, Cora said tonelessly. All he had to do to find his way back was follow the shoreline north. If he didn't come back here, it's because something happened to him.
We aren't going to find him in the dark. If he doesn't turn up, we can take the plane to Juno and come back with a real search party. If I can get us off the water, we'll make it to town, and if not...
Lawson stopped. Looking into her face, he saw real fear there. Even if Russell came back, she might not want anything to do with Alaska again, and this was the best chance that he would ever have to convince her otherwise. He broke what was left of the fudge bar in two and offered her the larger piece. After a beat, she took it. Lawson chewed on his own half for a minute before speaking again.
I wanted to ask you something.
Cora glanced at him warily. They were seated close to the barrel stove.
What?
I want to know what you're really doing here. Your husband gave me his version, but I don't think he came all this way to prove that some old sourdough saw a mirage.
Lawson fed a chunk of wood into the fire. I've seen strange things over the ice. All pilots have. There's nothing unusual in that. Cora seemed to weigh her words.
This isn't an ordinary
mirage. It's what they call a fata morgana. I'll show you. She took a piece of paper and the pencil stub from the table. For a second, she seemed to study the pencil in her hand, and then she turned to him again. You're sure you're interested? Lawson gave a slight shrug. It passes the time, and I like hearing you talk. He saw her blush. Cora lowered her head and drew a diagram on the page. It's called a superior mirage, which means that it appears higher in the sky than the original object. You tend to see them in cold climates over something like an ice sheet, which causes a layer of cold air to form under a warmer area in the opposite of the usual arrangement. A thermal inversion. As she spoke, the weariness seemed to leave her voice. Light from the object is refracted when it hits the inversion, which bends it along the curve of the Earth. If you're in the atmospheric duct, you can see it from hundreds of miles away. She put the pencil down. That's what Willoughby saw. Lawson pretended to study the drawing. And what was the object behind it? Maybe nothing. A fata morgana can be caused by as little as a stretch of coastline or a land formation. The spires that people see are produced by turbulence in the air. Nothing more to it than that. He decided to play his last card. That's a pretty good story. Now tell me the truth. Cora looked up sharply. Something was stirring behind her green eyes. Excuse me? The truth, Lawson repeated. You didn't come here for a mirage. When I asked for the money for the charter, your husband didn't blink. He thinks there's something real here. I'm not saying I believe it, but if you're serious, you need someone like me to help you. Cora seemed to make her choice. Have you heard of a man called Charles Fort? Lawson remembered the name from the book on the table, but he decided not to mention it. I don't think so. Cora turned toward the fire. He was a writer too, like Sam, but more so. He spent his life in museums and libraries looking for accounts of unexplained events. A club of his friends would meet at his apartment to talk about the unknown. Fort didn't welcome the attention. He didn't like being held up as an authority. But Sam cared about him a lot. And so did I. In the firelight, her face was difficult to read. Fort died 7 years ago. He just collapsed. Leukemia. I went to see him in the hospital before he went. It's where I met Sam. He wanted to take over from Fort, who tried to cover too much at once. Sam thought that you should focus on one problem at a time, and the Silent City seemed like a good place to start. Fort even gave him his blessing. If he spent years looking into it, why is he coming up to Alaska only now? Sam had to save up money for the trip. And he got sidetracked for a few years covering the war in Spain. He also wanted to put together all the pieces, and he realized that there was more to the story than even Willoughby knew. Cora went to the table and pulled out the picture of the Silent City. Look at the photo. It's an obvious hoax, an ordinary picture of Bristol. But before Willoughby started selling it to the tourists as the real thing, other witnesses had already claimed that the city looked like Bristol, too. That's over 4,000 miles away. There's no way that a mirage could come even a tenth of that distance. So what was it about the city in the sky that reminded them of it? Lawson looked at the picture again. He saw no more there than before. You tell me. Bristol is a city of spires. Some eyewitnesses even claim to recognize a church called St. Mary Redcliffe. It's got a row of pinnacles and a spire with a cross like this. Cora sketched a vertical column with four smaller lines projecting from the top. The accounts differ, but they all mention the spires. You said that the spires were probably just caused by turbulence in the air. That's true of some Fata Morgana images, but it doesn't make sense here. A cold mass of air over ice would be relatively still. and all of the accounts say that the city was stationary. It would hang there in the sky for more than 20 minutes, and it appears in late June and the middle of July, near the summer solstice, when sunset lasts the longest, which would draw out the phenomenon. The men who witnessed it weren't fools. Whatever they saw was real. Lawson began to see that she was just as cracked as her husband. So what was it? There are plenty of descriptions, but they don't agree. Some witnesses say that the city looked like Bristol, but there are others who compare it to Montreal, Toronto, or even Peking. Others say that whatever it wasn't European. You know what that says to me? Lawson had a hunch, but he was more fascinated by the light in her eyes. What? It reminds me of a famous detective story, maybe you've read it. A voice is overheard arguing in a room. One witness thinks it was talking in German, another in English, another in Russian. None of them can speak the language themselves, but they think they can recognize it by the sound. The speaker turns out to be an orangutan. Cora smiled. And if people say that a city looks like Bristol, Montreal, or Peking, they're really all saying the same thing without knowing it. It's something strange, alien, or from another time. You think I'm crazy, don't you? This last question took him by surprise. He wanted to warn her not to throw away her life on this, but he only shrugged. I wouldn't know. I don't mind. Cora regarded him with evident amusement. I've been doing all the talking. Tell me, what made you come out to Alaska? He had rarely been asked this before. There wasn't much for me on the outside. That's what I thought. It draws people who have been pushed to the margins. They have nowhere else to go. The same is true of ideas. Some of us end up on the fringes. It can become a sickness. You know why prospectors go mad? It's because you have to be nuts to go looking for gold in the first place. You could say the same thing about writers. But I love Sam and I don't want to lose him. Anyway, you knew all this before I even said a word. Cora held up the pencil. You went through my papers. Did you take the money? Lawson felt his face grow warm. You can count it. If I looked at your notes, it was because I wanted to know what we were doing here. I stand to lose a lot on this trip, and I had to know why. He came forward until they were close enough to touch. If it matters, I believe you, or at least that you're telling the truth. Hell, for all I know, maybe Willoughby really did see a city from the past. Behind him, the door of the cabin opened. When he turned, he saw the shape of a man outlined against the darkness. You're wrong, Russell said. It wasn't a city of the past. It's a city of the future. A quote by Charles Fort from New Lands. In the New York Times, October 31st, 1889, is an account by Mr. L.B. French of Chicago of the spectral representation, as he saw it, near Mount Fairweather. We could see plainly houses and trees. Here and there rose tall spires over huge buildings, which appeared to be ancient mosques or cathedrals. It did not look like a modern city, more like an ancient European city. Russell lowered himself into the nearest chair and began to unlace his boots. Lawson saw that he was carrying his right leg stiffly, and that something had been bound around his knee so that it strained against the fabric. Russell noticed him looking. Give me a hand with this, will you? As Cora stood in the corner, Lawson helped the older man roll up his trouser cuff, which was stained with fresh mud. When the knee was revealed, he saw that Russell had wrapped it in a brace of heavy material in which he had punched holes, lacing it together with the drawstring from his knapsack. A second later, he realized that it was the leather cover of the Book of the Damned by Charles Fort. Russell grinned. Fort would have appreciated it. Every writer likes to think that his work will be useful. He undid the lacing. Underneath, his kneecap was discolored by an ugly bruise, with red welts, like teeth marks, running to either side.
Lawson took the flask from his pocket and offered the other man a drink, which he accepted. Then they sat in silence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.